بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله الحمد لله، قدم من شاء بفضله وأخر من شاء بعدله، لا يعترض عليه ذو عقل بعقله، ولا يسأله مخلوق عن علة فعله. نحمده على القدر خيره وشره، ونشكره على القضاء حلوه ومره، أنعم على العاصي بستره، ورزق الكافر مع كفره. ومن آياته أن تقوم السماء والأرض بأمره. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له شهادة عبده وابن عبده وشهادة عبده وابن أمته، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أظهر دينه على الدين كله، أجل من وطئ الحصى بنعله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله الأطهار، لا سيما أبا بكر صاحب الغار، وعمر فاتح الأمصار، وعثمان شهيد الدار، وعليا قامع الأشرار، والمهاجرين والأنصار. ما تعطرت الأفواه بالصلاة والسلام على خير الأبرار وخير الأنام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحابته. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد، عليكم يا أحبتنا السلام، وأتحفكم المولى برحمته والسلام، وبوأكم مساكن طيبات تحية من تبوأها سلام، فالسلام عليكم ورحمته وبركاته. معشر المسلمين، يقول ربي وربكم عز وجل: أم حسبتم أن تتركوا ولما يعلم الله الذين جاهدوا منكم ويعلم الصابرين، أم حسبتم أن تدخلوا الجنة ولما يأتكم مثل الذين خلوا من قبلكم مستهم البأساء والضراء وزلزلوا حتى يقول الرسول والذين آمنوا معه متى نصر الله؟ أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون؟ أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون؟ ولقد فتن الذين من قبلهم. To all of you, our brothers in Iman, sisters in Ihsan, Respected non-Muslims in Insan, I speak to you today, observing all problems of the world, issues, unbridled violence, sordid afflictions, that wherever you turn your sight, people, some are confused. Those with ultimate and extra patience are confused. We living in a time when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is mentioned, people do not even move their lips for the most part. But when Iblis or Satan is mentioned, others say radiallahu anhu. To this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned the ummah, badiru bil a'mal, stand up in righteousness, compete with one another. Before seeing the following seven, هل تنتظرون إلا فقرا منسيا أو غنى مطغيا أو مرضا مفسدا أو هرما مفندا أو موتا مجهزا أو الدجال فشر غائب ينتظر أو الساعة فالساعة أدهى وأمر. What are you waiting for? Are you waiting for the following seven to take place before you reflect and go back to your Lord? What are you anticipating sitting down waiting to take place before returning to Allah? Our Prophet is asking, are you waiting for poverty that will wash some people's brain, that they get confused? We living in poverty, how can we return to Allah? We have to please in order for us to eat. Are you waiting for that to take place before you reflect? Before you think deeply? Before you cogitate over the issues that are you witnessing? Before I finish the rest of the seven, I will mention 10 events today that if we take and practice them in our lives, the violence that we see, unmitigated turmoil that we witnessing, all the afflictions around the world today, implementing the following 10. Early in the morning, we will wake up like nothing had happened. The first event is the event between Prophet Muhammad sallallahu wasallam alayhi and the tribe of Daws. The second event is that which took place between Shaykhain. When they say Shaykhan, they're referring to Abi Bakr and Umar. The third event is what took place during the Bani Umayyah dynasty, letters sent by Yazid ibn Abd al-Malik to the Wali of Iraqain, Ibn Hubayr. The fourth event is what took place between آخر ملوك بني العباس المعتصم بالله and الوزير ابن العلقمي. The fifth event is what took place between Genghis Khan and his grandson Hulaku. Genghis Khan and Hulaku. The sixth event is what took place in France in 1700 when Maximilian Robespierre gained his own power. The seventh event is what took place amid the reign of Joseph Stalin. The eighth event is that of Adolf Hitler of Germany. The ninth event is the gaining of power that took place in Italy under the leadership of Benito Mussolini. The tenth event and the last of today's khutbah is the event of February 2011 in Libya. 10 events, with Allah's permission, if time allows, we will mention some in details and others, just going over them to glean some lessons, take some benefits, implement them in our lives, so that our problems today, our issues today, our own mashakil today, our own fitan today, our own mihan today, to be taken care of by Allah subhanahu jalla fi'ula. The first event between Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the tribe of Ad-Daws. The Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam sent some of his companions, some of his disciples, to invite and distribute the message of this deen. The people of At-Tufail, they captured those companions, the messengers of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were captured. Some of them were killed and their bodies chopped into pieces. And the etiquette that Arabs, even before Islam, practiced was, as a messenger, regardless of his message or the magnitude of what he carries, it's not appropriate for him to be killed. But they killed the messengers of Allah's messenger, chopped them into pieces. Some of the Sahaba rapidly dashed to our Nabi and said to him, they said to him, Ya Rasulullah, this is what happened to your own companions. It's what happened to your own Sahaba. That's what they did to them. Make dua against them. Prophet ﷺ put his own over and the top garment and stood up in mihrab. When he faced his member, facing the mihrab, the rest of the Sahaba said, doom. The tribe of Daws are done. Prophet is about to make dua against them. He's about to make dua against them. And if Prophet ﷺ makes dua, you know where the dua will go. The dua will penetrate the sky. And in less than 9 seconds, you see Jibreel answering with Ameen, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepting the Ameen of angels, case closed. So they said to those tribe, you have to make tawbah. Prophet is about to make dua against you. Turn to Allah, make your own shahada to Allah, because Prophet is about to make dua against you. But when Prophet stood in front of his mihrab, he did not make dua against those. He did not invoke Almighty against them. He did not implore the wrath of Allah against them. Rather, what he said, Allahumma hdi dawsan wa'tibihim. O Allah, guide the tribe of Daws and bring all of them to me as Muslims. Who will make dua or this type of dua today? Somebody killing your companions, those that you planted their loves in your own heart, you loved them daily, and people liquidated them, massacred and eradicated all of them, and standing in mihrab making dua, ihdi dawsan wa atibihim, guide them and bring them to me as Muslims. And now people will be confused and attribute to Islam that this is the deen calling to terrorism. You turn this statement even to he or she that has no mind will tell you, no, that's not true. If Prophet will make dua, Allahumma hdi dawsan, guide those tribe of those, bring them to me as Muslims. Not long time passing by, the tribe of those, they took their own route to Prophet and they kneeled down before him and said, we came to you. Nashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa annaka rasulullah. We bear witness the only one worthy of worship is the one who sent you as a prophet, and that you are the seal of all prophets and messengers of Allah. And from today, we will never bow down to somebody else except the one who set up this sky as canopy for all, and also earth outspread for us as a place of rest. And now you are the only prophet that we will follow you as Rasulullah, and we are all to you Muslims. That's the power of Islam. That's the might that Allah gave this deen of Islam. Our power is Quran. Our power is Sunnah. Our power is the methodology of the Sahaba. Our power is what they left for us. Salafun idha marra zamanu bidhikrihim waqafa zamanu lahum mujillan mukbira. Those are our Salaf. Those are the rightly guided predecessors that we are proud of. So all of them that followed the steps of Quran, they became the most powerful. So our Quran is power. The Sunnah of Khayr al-Anam is power. The way is power. Everything that Allah gave this Ummah is power. Bi Qur'anina quwwa, bi kitabillahi quwwa, wa bi sunnati al-gharra'i quwwa, wa bi i'tina'i bi tariqati salaf al-ummati quwwa. Innana quwwa wa bi quwwati Allahi quwwa. وَبِقُرْآنِنَا قُوَّةٌ وَاللَّهِ لَا يَعْدِلُهُ قُوَّةٌ. Whatever Allah gave us Muslims, it's nothing but power and source of strength. But now we're searching for power somewhere else and we neglect the power that He gave us. The first event. Now someone who is making dua for those who have taken him as number one enemy, inviting them to the deen, making dua for them to be guided, asking Allah sincerely out of his heart for them to embrace this deen. What do you think he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, will do if he is still alive? Or what he had done if he had witnessed what's going on today? The first is to invite peace. The first is to inculcate the message of this deen in people's mind. That's what he did. That's what he called to. And even when people deny the truth, and people deny the faith, and people deny his way, see him bothered. فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ النَّفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ أَثَارِهِمْ أَنْ لَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعُ النَّفْسَكَ. And Prophet ﷺ kept on receiving this ayat, the ayah of Surah Kahf, the ayah of Surah Tasim Mim, Surah Shu'ara, the ayah of ayat naming the positions of Prophet ﷺ, the way he, peace be upon him, is bothered when iman or faith is denied and repudiated. And now you will tell the world, or listen to what media will tell you, that what he gave this ummah to shed people's blood and kill. No, his first method is to give da'wah to others. The same thing Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu wa ardah took this khilafah, and when he became the khalifa, the first thing he said to those Muslims, that I'm here to lead all of you, and if I'm right, get to know I'm upholding the statement of Allah, and if I go wrong and err on my own calculation, do not follow my evil way of thinking. Why? Because it's from me. If I'm right, it's from Allah. If I'm wrong, it's from me. and shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger, they have nothing to do with my own wrong. So follow me so long as I stand up before you with this kitab and with this Quran. That was what he said, and he appointed Umar as the wali of Medina. And he said to Umar, Umar be the wali and the qadi of this Medina. He said to Umar, be the qadi, the judge over these people of Medina. Umar became the qadi of Medina. The first month, nobody came to Umar. The second month, nobody came to Umar. Third, nobody showed up. Fourth, nobody came. 10 months, nobody is coming to Umar. 11th, nobody came. 12th, nobody complained. For complete 1 year, nobody, two persons did not come to Umar and complain about something or say we fought among ourselves or we in trouble or between us we have some argumentation penetrating. Nobody came. Umar went to Abi Bakr and he said to Abi Bakr, please, I ask you to forgive me. I can't take this position and I don't want to be the qadi of Medina anymore. Then Abi Bakr asked Umar, Ya Umar, amin mashaqqati al-qada'a? Amin mashaqqati al-qada'i tatlubu al-i'fa'a, Ya Umar? Is that you are overwhelmed? Are you overwhelmed with the position and people bothering you? That's why you want to give up? He said, no, it's not like I want to give up. How can I be a qadi of Medina and nobody had complained and those are the people? مَا لِي بِحَاجَةٍ مِّن قَوْمٍ مُؤْمِنِينَ قَدْ عَرِفَ وَعَرَفَ كُلُّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمْ حَقَّهُ وَحَقَّ غَيْرِهِ. All of them, they knew what Allah said in Quran. They following the footsteps of this deen. The shara of Allah is what guides them. The sunnah of Rasulullah is what they follow. So there's not even point of being qadi over them because they do not wrong one another. If one of them is sick, you see them going to visit him. If he is in trouble, you see them delivering him out of that trouble. If in deep dejection, you see them supporting and aiding. What else can Umar do? Is that our situation today? Someone sick, they go like family. Somebody in trouble, they all respond. Somebody's missing, where is this person? Someone is not being seen, let's go and check out what's going on with him. That was how Sahaba of Rasulullah lived as one. Single ummah, one single body, interlocked and together, and nobody able. None was able to separate those companions. مَتَى صَدِئَ النَّاسُ لَا يَصْدَعُونَ كَأَنَّهُمُ الذَّهَبُ الْأَحْمَرُ. You see, when people disguise, they do not disguise. When people fade and fake, you see them, they do not. When people turn their backs to the way of the deen, you see them up front. When the banner of La ilaha illallah is forgotten about, you see them up front. هم الضراغم والشم البهاليل كأنكم في دياجين قناديل أسد وغاباتكم سمر القنا ولهم في نصرة الحق إسراع وتعجيل وهم الجبال فيا لله من عجب كيف استقلت بهم نوق الشماليل أحيوا ضريبتهم وأعطوا ضريبتهم للدين من دمهم ونحن أولى في زعمنا الدين مجانا زينوا الأرض كما قد زينت بنجوم الليل آفاق الفلق هم منار الفقر مبنى فخره وهم منار الصدق مبنى فخره لا وهت أركانها تلك المباني. When people turn, you see them making a U-turn to Allah. When people forget about the messenger of Allah, you see them up front, reminding people what's supposed to be done. That's how they lived. And this is the reason why the fragrance of their own behavior extended to those who came after them. And those who came after them, until people began to forget their method and their way that they lived, then Almighty left us alone by ourselves. Now going back in Banu Umayyah dynasty, the Khalifa of Muslim, Yazid ibn Abd al-Malik, he used to write a letter to Ibn Hubayr, who was the wali, you can say like a governor of Al-Iraqayn. When they say Iraqan, they're referring to Kufa and Basra. So he was like a governor of these two well-known cities there. Iraqayn the Wali of Iraqain, Ibn Hubayr. So he received letters from Yazid ibn Abdul Malik. And some of the things that Yazid asked him in the letter, some are not based on what pleases Allah. Certain things that Yazid ibn Abdul Malik mentioned go against the way of Islam. So he became confused and Atlik puzzled. So he called two imams. He called Amir al-Sha'bi and he called Hassan al-Basri. Two of them, he said, please, I want your advice. Advise me as opposed to what to do concerning the letter that I received from Yazid ibn Abdul Malik. Sometime he asked me to do something, I complied. And he kept on asking, but certain things, I'm afraid that if I stand before Allah on the day of Qiyamah, I will have a big trouble. Why? Because certain things not based on the deen of Allah. So now what to do? Amir al-Sha'bi, he gave Yazid ibn Abdul Malik, not directly, but through Hubayr, who received the letter. He said to him, well, he is the Khalifa. And you know what Khalifa does if someone goes against him. So he answered him in that nature. You know, covering the truth, dressing up the code of it, and not going straight with him. So he gave him the answer that he wanted to hear. And Hassan al-Basri was next to him quietly, not speaking. So Ibn Hubayrah, he said to him, مَا لَكَ يَا أَبَا سَعِيد? Why are you not speaking, Abu Sa'id? Abu Sa'id is Hassan al-Basri. Abu Sa'id, will you please say something? So he kept on listening to what another imam is saying. You know those imams, they did not care about dunya or how to please people. What they care about is what will make people to be free when they stand before Allah. And that should be the mind of each and every imam who is blessed with knowledge and blessed with ilm, especially when you are given an opportunity to guide people and call them to Allah. Is that to make sure what you say to them is what will free them from the punishment and the wrath of Allah in dunya as well as akhirah. So Hassan al-Basri did not want to argue with Abu Sa'id, or Abu Sa'id Hassan al-Basri, they didn't want to argue with Amir al-Sha'bi. So he remained quiet. Ibn Hubayrah, why Abu Sa'id, you're not talking? He said, the reason, you know, the imam is talking. He said, no, I want to hear from you what you have to say in this regard, in this issue, in this letter that came from Yazid ibn Abdul Malik, the Khalifa of Muslims at the time. Hassan al-Basri gave him an answer that I believe Muslims of 21st century, this is what we missing. Muslims in the Western world, this is what we missing. Muslim in the Arab world, that's what they're missing. Muslims in Africa, this is what we are missing today. Muslims in Europe, this is what we are missing today. Muslims today, if we implement the statement of Hassan al-Basri, our issues will be gone. Hassan al-Basri responded affirmatively saying, well, يَبْنَ هُبَيْرَ خَفِ اللَّهَ فِي يَزِيدٍ وَلَا تَخَفْ يَزِيدَ فِي اللَّهِ يَبْنَ هُبَيْرَةَ خَفِ اللَّهَ فِي يَزِيدٍ وَلَا تَخَفْ يَزِيدَ فِي اللَّهِ. Meaning, O son of Hubayr, fear Allah in the affairs of Hubayr or Ibn Hubayr. Make sure you fear Allah and have taqwa of Allah in your heart when it comes to whatever Ibn Yazid say. But whatever Allah says, don't fear Yazid in it. What comes from Allah should be your point of focus. What Ibn Hubayr, you Ibn Hubayr, what Yazid is saying, do not pay mind. Make sure whatever comes to you, you place it before Allah's statement. You place it before the statement of Allah's prophet and check it out. Is that something that pleases Allah? Is that something that makes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala content with your situation? خَفِ اللَّهَ فِي يَزِيدٍ وَلَا تَخَفْ يَزِيدَ فِي اللَّهِ. Fear Allah in Yazid and do not fear Yazid in Allah. I.e. and that is to say that fear Allah in the affairs of Yazid,
the matters of Yazid, have taqwa in Allah in whatever He tells you to do. But when Allah asks you to do something, don't care about what Yazid says. That's if you want direct answer that will save thy soul and your soul. But if you want me to go around, if you want me to go around the bush and turn into Lincoln Navigator, I cannot navigate and leave the truth and tell you something else. And then he went forward to say, Yabna Hubayra, Yabna Hubayra, Innahu yushiku an yanzila bika malakun ghalithun shadid la ya'si Allah ma amara fayuziluka min saririk wa yanquluka min sa'ati qasrika ila dhiqi qabrika. Yabna Hubayra, hark the following statement. Soon an angel will descend on you, and that angel is so strong and powerful and also built with extra might and power by Allah, that when he descends, the way you think you can disobey Allah and follow Yazid, that angel, when he descends, he doesn't disobey Allah. What Allah asked him to do, or what Allah asked of him, is what he applies. And upon his arrival, he will snatch you from that comfortable, that place of your own, you know, palace. He will snatch you out of your own bed and take you from that spacious place of yours in your own palace. He's just gonna take you from that spacious place to that confined one. What is that spacious place? Your own palace. What is the confined one? That's your own qabr. But guess what? In that place, لن ينفعك ولن تنفعك طاعتك ليزيد وإنما تجد عملك الذي خالفت فيه رب يزيد. And that when you are laid in your own grave and people leave you by yourself and you lying down there and nobody is there to even ask you, do you need help? By yourself, son of Hubayra, being there in your grave, Yazid will not be there with you. The only thing that will be with you on that day is your own deed that you went against Allah because of pleasing Yazid. Muslims, this is just a scenario. إِنَّكَ إِن تَكُمْ مَعَ اللَّهِ وَفِي طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ يَكْفِكَ اللَّهُ بَائِقَةَ يَزِيدٍ. If you are with Allah, son of Hubayra, if you follow the way of Allah, son of Hubayra, and you obey Allah subhanahu jalla fi ula, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you from all wrath and evil of Yazid. But if you obey Yazid, Yazid cannot protect you before Allah. Muslims, that's why today, if you are confused about your religion, if you are confused about your deen, and you want to do certain things, the ones that you're supposed to ask, not the ones that make deen easy on you. They will make it easier on you today, but you will be in trouble tomorrow. So will you prefer to be in good, you know, you don't want to live that austere lifestyle because you want to be comfortable. So you follow the imams that make things easier on you. But the ones that telling you what Allah wants from you, you don't want to listen. Remember Hassan al-Basri, يَبْنَ غُبَيْرَةَ إِنَّكَ إِن تَكُمْ مَعَ اللَّهِ وَفِي طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ يَكْفِكَ اللَّهُ بَائِقَةَ يَزِيدٍ وَإِن تَكُمْ مَعَ يَزِيدَ وَتَتْرُكْ أَمْرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّكَ لَن تَجِدَ فِي قَبْرِكَ إِلَّا عَمَلُكَ الَّذِي خَالَفْتَ فِيهِ رَبَّ يَزِيد. If you go against Allah and you please Yazid, Yazid will leave you the day that nobody will be with you in your grave except your deed. But if you please Allah in your grave, Yazid is not there, but you have your Lord there with you, with his own ilm. This is how the imams lived. Why? Because if you obey someone to go against the rule of Allah, you obey someone to plot against somebody else. If you obey somebody and you flip on somebody else, the one that you help to flip on somebody, he's gonna flip on you today or tomorrow. If you help someone wrongly, without just, without right, wrongly, you help somebody against somebody else, he will flip on you tomorrow. This is the sunnah of Allah. الظالم يرمى بالظالم. The wrongdoer is cast by another wrongdoer. You help to go against the method of your own religion, your own Lord who had created you to please somebody, the same way he helped you to go against somebody, the same way he or she helped you to do some things wrong, if your day comes, your body will be against you. Your comrade, always, if you will please somebody through somebody else, you displease Allah, you go against Allah in pleasing somebody, that person will flip on you sooner or later. This is what happened. That's why Imam Hassan al-Basri is reminding Yabna Hubayra, Yabna Hubayra, Yabna Hubayra. If you do this, remember the result. If you do this, remember the result. If you do that, remember the result. So do not do what you please or what you feel comfortable. Always see what makes your Lord comfortable so that your life to be protected by Allah the time you need Allah subhanahu jalla fi ula. The leader of khulafa, the khalifa of Muslims, amid the time of Bani al-Abbas, the last and the final king of al-Abbasiyin was al-Mu'tasim billah. Al-Mu'tasim billah was khalifa of Muslims. He was in Baghdad, the Asimatul Khalifa, the capital where Muslims' power reside, where Muslim strength sticks. At the time, the leader of Muslim Khalifatul Muslimin, Al-Mu'tasim Billah. Mu'tasim Billah didn't care about the deen. He did not take lessons from the life of Khulafa al-Rashideen, Abi Bakr wa Umar wa Uthman wa Ali wa Ambaqiyat al-Sahaba. No, what he cared about is his own pleasure, his ego pleasure, his own pleasure. That's it. Guess what happened? He started selling his own people to junkies. He started selling his own people to Hulaku. At the end, see what happened? His own deputy, next, his right-hand man, Ibn al-Alqami, he flipped on him and he came behind him. He started meeting Hulaku secretly and Mu'tasim doesn't even know. You help him to flip on others, now he's helping them to flip on you. That's what happened to Muslims the time they left behind the leadership that Allah gave them, the power that Allah gave us. When we put that power and strength behind, that's what happened. Al-Mu'tasim is in trouble now. He thought, well, let me just send the imams to please Hulaku, and once Hulaku is content and happy with me, I'm saved. So he said, well, why don't you bring all and everybody from Baghdad, the leaders, the imams, the qudha, the ru'a, bring everybody. Hulaku said, I have a good gift for you. So you, al-wazir, Ibn al-Alqami, if you help me to capture that Mu'tasim, I will put you as the leader of Baghdad and Khalifat al-Muslimin. He became happy. At the end, long story short, he sold out the Khalifa of Muslims, because the Khalifa of Muslims himself sold Muslims. So now the one who helped him to flip on Muslims is flipping on. He sold him out. Guess what? When the day of Zina arrived, when the day that they're supposed to meet came, they all went. The first thing Hulaku said, he said, well, you know, capture the leader, this, his qudha, the imams, make sure, you know, before sunset, you execute all of them. Now Wazir is happy. Ibn al-Alqami is happy. He said, mashallah, now I get what I want. So they took all of them and everybody. So he came up in front of Hulaku. He said to him, well, now I've done my part, and now that I sold all the Muslims to you, and mind you, that's another Muslim with his turban. He said, now that I sold all of them to you, your promise to me. Hulaku said, take him and make sure he's one of those to be killed, because if he will help his own leader to flip on his own leader, if he is here with me, he's gonna flip on me. Finish him up. That's what happened to Muslims. After Muslims, after Muslims, after Muslims, after Muslims, after Muslims, till today. What we saw in February of 2011 around the world is not neat. That took place. But it's just that Muslims, what we are blessed with, we do not pay attention. We think that we have our source of power and strength somewhere else, not what Allah gave us. Same thing, if you remember, since we ran out of time, Maximo Rebespo, the same thing, the lawyer in France in 1700s, same thing, he gained power. The people that he trusted, they flipped on him. Here's Joseph Stalin of Italy. In 1940s, who can stand in front of, you know, Joseph Stalin, Uncle Joe? Who can dare to challenge his authority? He get power, strength, everything that even his own family doesn't trust. He doesn't trust them. That the amount of blood that I shed on this earth, right here, somebody responsible of 20 million souls, liquidating them all, slaughtering them all. Now the one who stood up to support him was his own chief of police, Yajur. Yajur came to Joseph Stalin and he said to him, well, you know, we finished with all of them. Then Joseph Stalin started thinking that this guy, this amount of power that he got, if I leave him longer, you know, he may be in trouble. Joseph Stalin used to predict. He is the one who will tell you who to live and who to die. With his own handwriting, no, execute this, take off this, let this live, let this. The same way, the one who supported Joseph Stalin to kill all those people, at the end, Joseph Stalin said, you know, it's your time to go too. You help someone to flip on the statement on the slaves of Allah, the lives that Allah rooted for people, that blessed them with, just taking their lives easy like that. That's the same thing that happened. That's what took place and kept on moving slowly and slowly. The same thing Idi Amin Dada, the president of Uganda in 1970s, the same thing happened. That he kept on, even his own three wives, he get one of them killed, chopped her meat into pieces, and he asked the doctors, I want you to sew her body back because I want to do something. They did, and brought his own children to watch. Those that helped him to flip on others, they started flipping on him, his own cousin. هَكَذَا يُرُمَ الظَّالِمُ بِالظَّالِمِ. If you help to go against the way of Allah, and those who are not in the situation or position of being troubled, you trouble them, yours is coming soon. The same thing happened in Libya in 2012, in 2011. The same thing and the same idea and mindset. In Arabic adage, they have the following statement: "Alijhu bidhabhi taisi hatta yafza alqirdu." In Arabic, they have this proverb that if somebody start to act up against you, or if you see a monkey is disturbing you, bring a goat. A tais is a male goat. The male goat, the one with beard, is called in Arabic a tais. So they say in Arabic, if you see a monkey is disturbing you, make sure you bring a goat. That tais, slaughter the goat in front of the qird, that monkey will leave you alone. So this is the mentality of some leaders and the way they went in their own ghay, in their own utu, in their own ghayihim wa utuwihim wa baghiyihim. So عَالِجُهُ بِذَبْحِ التَّيْسِ حَتَّى يَفْزَعَ الْقِرْدُ. The strong ones, make sure you liquidate, you kill them all so that the feeble will fear you. Prophet ﷺ gave us advice that when you see issues going and problems, return back and make sure you please Allah. When you please Allah, He owns and He has the heart of your leaders between His own fingers. So if you please Him, He will change the heart of your leaders. But if you want to change their heart by force, those who are not worthy of being killed will be the one to die. And that's what we're saying. That's what is going on. So the nasi'ah of Rasulullah, isbiru atta talqawni ala al-hawd. Be patient until you meet me, when you see me in front of the hawd. The people in Afghan, عُلِجُوا بِذَبْحِ التَّيْسِ حَتَّى فَزِعَ الْقِرْدُ وَأَهْلُ يَمَنْ عُلِجُوا بِذَبْحِ التَّيْسِ حَتَّى فَزِعَ الْقِرْدُ وَأَهْلُ غَزَّةَ عُلِجُوا بِذَبْحِ التَّيْسِ حَتَّى فَزِعَ الْقِرْدُ وَأَهْلُ مِصْرَ عُلِجُوا بِذَبْحِ التَّيْسِ حَتَّى فَزِعَ الْقِرْدُ وَأَهْلُ لِبْيَا عُلِجُوا بِذَبْحِ التَّيْسِ حَتَّى فَزِعَ الْقِرْدُ وَأَهْلُ وَغَدُغُ عُلِجُوا بِذَبْحِ التَّيْسِ حَتَّى فَزِعَ الْقِرْدُ وَهَكَذَا وَهَكَذَا الظالم يرمي الظالم بغيره فإنهم أقلعوا ورجعوا إلى بارئهم كفى الله المؤمنين القتال. If we return back to him سبحانه جل في علاه, then we make sure that what he asked us to do and following the code of Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم that we started with, remembering and recalling what he did, the situation between him and the tribe of those. Allahumma hdi dawsan wa'ti bihim. That was the mercy that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. That was his own mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala vouchsafed on him. Ma arafat al bashariyyah khayrun min wa la dabba 'ala al habasitati man huwa ahsanu min azka al wara wa ajallu man wati al hasa qadran wa akramu shafi'in wa mushaffai. He is the best of the best in terms of dealing with people, in terms of being merciful, in terms of guiding, in terms of showing them the way, in terms of showing them the light. In darkness he is the light, and in light he is the way. We return back to his way, we are saved. We erect our own solution, Allah will leave us alone. And remember Hassan al-Basri, قد قلت ما قلت إن صوابا فمن الله وإن عكس ذلك فمني ومن الشيطان والله ورسوله منه براء. ادعوا الله يستجب لكم واعلموا أن التائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له. الحمد لله, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد, to wrap up and make دعاء, cause it's time, we ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى, the situation and the problems all over the world, we ask him to rescue all of us, especially the young ones. You the young ones, whether being here the students of Minhal, the boys and the girls alike, the young Muslims of today, you have a lot to go through tomorrow. The deen is the way out. If you think otherwise, you're not being honest to yourself. People are left in darkness. Until now, each and everyone taking the position or the responsibility of changing our situation in his own or her own hand. People don't even know, most for the most part, don't even know what to do. 3 years I was in LA, California, sisters so confused to a point, they said, we even tired of problems in the masjid, let's go open sister's masjid. In San Diego, just 2 months ago, I was then next to each masjid, you see a hookah place. Young boys down in Minnesota, 6 months ago, I was there. What they're thinking about? You know, we tired of all problems, the uncles and the aunties, those old, the leaders of our communities, problems all over the place, problems every day. Let's go open a masjid online. Have you heard the masjid online? That's when people now get confused. So Muslims, a lot to be said, but remember, if Prophet ﷺ will deal with those who dealt with his own companions by killing all of them, yet he came out with dua for guidance, make dua for your own guidance, for your own family, for your own community, for your own people. And that being said, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to change us with his own help, and that we are able or turn to be of those who submit themselves to Allah. Allahumma ayyid al-Islam wa a'izz al-Muslimin. اللهم أعز الإسلام ووفق المسلمين. اللهم إنا نسألك حبك وحب من يحبك وحب كل عمل يقربنا إلى حبك. نسألك اللهم فكاك الأسير، وفق المسلمين لما تحب وترضى، وخذ بنواصينا للبر والتقوى، وخذ بنواصينا للبر والتقوى. And finally wrapping up, I'm gonna recapitulate what I started with. The first event between Prophet and the tribe of Daus. The second event between Abi Bakr and Umar. The third event between Hubayra, Amir al-Shami along with Hassan al-Basri. The fourth one was that between this great Khalifa, but yet he left it by himself and we ran away from the responsibility, Al-Mu'tasimu Billah and his own Wazir. The fifth, Genghis Khan, taking the position and finishing them all. The sixth that we mentioned today is that of Max Munir-Basper, though we did not get chance to delve in details. The seventh, Joseph Stalin, with all the power and the might Allah gave him at the end, he died in his own office, just like the way rats and mice die in their own spots, by himself, like he never gained power. And after Benito Mussolini, time did not allow us to go into details. And then after that, we talked about Idi Amin, Dada of Uganda. And finally, we talked about the situation down in Libya. عُلِجُوا بِذَبْحِ التَّيْسِ حَتَّى فَزِعَ الْقِرْدُ وَالْعَرَبُ عُلِجُوا بِذَبْحِ التَّيْسِ حَتَّى فَزِعَ الْقِرْدُ. اللهم وفق المسلمين لما تحب وترضى، وخذ بنواصينا للبر والتقوى. لبيك وسعديك، والخير كله في يديك، نحن منك وإليك. ثم الصلاة والسلام سرمدا على ختام الأنبياء أحمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين. ربي والحقنا بهم آمين. وقوموا إلى صلاتكم.